After a year on the road, I thought I'd get tired of traveling. The endless clatter of railways, highways, and everything in between. But as my train pulled into the station at Bellariva, I felt every bit as excited as the first day of my journey. A whole year. It felt like a lifetime. The places I'd seen, the people I'd met, of course, the forgotten treasures I'd given a new lease of life along the way. I'm a restorer by trade. Bringing our most beloved possessions back to life is what I love to do. I'd been traveling for months, working my way from one town to the next, fixing everything from family heirlooms to VCRs. Bellariva was my chance to take a break. Unfortunately, that would have to wait until after I'd unpacked. I picked up these sunglasses on my last stop. Hopefully, I'm cool enough to pull them off. I saw a guitarist wearing these at a show once. Rock and roll repair woman, at your service. My passport. Not many blank pages left now. Who doesn't love a scrunchie? Practical and stylish. Looking forward to taking more close-ups of my fingers with this. My favorite overalls. These will never go out of style. The tools of my trade. No hope of restoring things without these. Finally, I'd made it to Bellariva. I'd come for the food festival, taking place in a few days' time. After living off TV dinners and instant ramen for the last few months, I was craving a decent meal. Of course, I'd need to earn enough money to pay for it, so I figured I'd head out the next day and find some work. My parents never wanted me to go. They wanted me to stay in their shop and have a simple, stationary life. I knew there was a world out there, beyond the four walls of our antique store that I had to be a part of. I daydreamed constantly about the weird and wonderful places each of our antiques came from. I loved figuring out their stories, revealing the memories hidden beneath the screws and wires. My story in Bellariva began with a little girl and a voice she was longing to hear. It was my first morning in Bellariva, and I couldn't wait to leave my hotel and explore. It was a quiet town, its streets and alleyways basking peacefully in the hot morning sun. In the main square, meanwhile, preparations were underway for the festival in a few days' time. As I handed out my flyers, I wondered what the people of Bellariva would need me to fix. So far, everything here seemed perfect. I was starting to worry I'd made a mistake, when I felt someone tapping me on the back.
Hi, I'm Izzy. Do you know how to fix things?
It was a little girl, maybe 7 years old, who must have gotten hold of one of my flyers. She rummaged around in her backpack until she hauled out a battered red cassette deck.
My tape is broken and I can't make it work anymore. I tried to fix it myself, but there's this metal thing in the way. Can you try?
look like they need replacing. Luckily, I have some spares.
Dream for me, if I sit by your side and hold you so tight.
When it finished, Izzy picked up the tape deck and tucked it carefully into her backpack.
Thanks, Maria. You're the best person at fixing things ever.
No problem. Who was that singing? They're very good.
It's my mom. She's not here anymore.
Izzy trailed off. It was the kind of silence a cassette tape would never be enough to fill. When Izzy's friends called for her, she dug deep into her pockets, looking for something to pay me with. Eventually, she produced a grand total of a stick of gum, 3 mismatched buttons, and a yo-yo. I usually preferred a check, but Izzy looked so serious, I wrote out a full receipt. She seemed like a happy kid, but beneath it all, part of her life had been shattered. The part I wouldn't be able to fix. My first repair complete, I spent the rest of the day doing small jobs in and around the square. I was exhausted when I got back to my hotel and found a message asking me to make one more visit. The address led me to a quaint little house, a stone's throw from the beach. Bathed in the evening light, it looked beautiful, in spite of its flaking paintwork and chipped tiles. The front door was opened by a harried-looking man, still dressed from a long day at the office.
Are you Maria? My name's Joseph. I'm Isabel's father. I'm so sorry she bothered you this morning. Please, come in. I'd like to settle up properly.
On the mantelpiece, I saw the remains of a broken statue. Without thinking, I picked up a fragment.
Ah, my father's statue. What's left of it, at least. Yet another way I'd have disappointed him. It survived 100 years in this family. But 5 minutes with Isabel and... Do you think you can salvage it? Will you be able to see the glue afterwards? I don't want people seeing the cracks. Sometimes I think my daughter should come with a warning label. Is this glue really strong enough to hold everything together? Thank you, Maria. It looks as perfect as it ever did. My father wanted me to make something of myself. He didn't have time for anything less.
As Joseph put the statue back on the shelf, it nudged against the family portrait stood proudly next to it. So he was Bellariva's mayor. And that was Izzy's mom. They must both miss her so much.
Sorry, I'm a little tired. I've been working late getting things sorted for the festival. There's only a few days to go. Looks like I'll be working late. Again?
When I told my parents I wanted to leave, they always found an excuse to be busy, to avoid talking about it. I guess keeping themselves occupied was their way of pretending it wasn't happening. Joseph's work must have been taking up so much of his time. But maybe that was what he wanted. I just hoped he was finding enough time for Izzy, too. My second day in Bellariva dawned bright and clear, another beautiful sunny morning. Walking into town, I passed cafes overflowing with customers cradling their morning coffees. I stopped, breathing in the smell of roasted coffee beans and freshly baked pastries. I was about to go inside when the owner of Carmen's, the cafe next door, stopped me.
Hello, Maria? Were you here yesterday handing out flyers? I have a job for you.
Her place was petite, tucked between its competitors as if hoping they wouldn't notice. Judging by the empty tables inside, though, her potential customers hadn't noticed it either.
It's a bit slow today, but we're just getting started. I'm sure it'll pick up soon.
As Carmen chatted, she walked over to the counter and returned with an old rotary phone.
At least I've got plenty of time to practice my recipe for the festival. It's a new special I've been working on. I was hoping to call my sister for some, seasoning tips, but it won't connect. Can you see if you can figure out what's wrong? You can fix it, can't you? I can't afford to replace it. Obviously, we'd normally be much busier than this.
Looks like this new circuit board is all hooked up. When I handed the phone back to Carmen, she seemed almost reluctant to take it from me.
So it's all working now, is it? I don't have to leave it to dry or let it cool down?
Nope, it's ready to go. It'll be ringing off the hook in no time.
That's if I can pay my phone bill anyway. And the rent, and the suppliers. Anyway, Take a seat and I'll be right with you. Your coffee's on the house.
I sat at one of the empty tables, while at the counter, Carmen had started dialing the phone.
Hello? How's my favorite sister doing today?
As she talked, Carmen became more and more tense. This didn't seem like a call for some cooking advice.
I know I still owe you from last time, but I can't afford to take part in the festival if I don't pay.
I could almost feel the eye roll at the other end of the line.
You don't need to be here, though. Can't you just put the check in the post?
When the call ended, Carmen brought me my coffee, her hands trembling.
Sorry about that. My sister's decided to fly in for a visit. Oh God, I have to get ready. Actually, I might have another job for you. Can you come by tomorrow?
The next day, I'd promised Carmen I'd return to help her get the cafe ready for her sister's arrival. I was about to set out when I received an unexpected call from my hotel's reception desk. Apparently, another guest had asked for me by name. Curious, I took the creaking elevator up to the top floor and made my way to the room number they'd given. I knocked.
Are you here about the camera? It's about time.
The woman in front of me was immaculate, not a hair out of place or a crease to be seen.
My sister tells me you know how to fix things. I'd usually go to an expert, of course, but in this town...
So this was Carmen's sister? The two of them couldn't have been more different. Inside her room, I saw a beautiful reflex camera, any professional photographer's dream.
The viewfinder is completely dark. I can't see anything through it at all. I assume you can figure out what's wrong. I don't suppose you've fixed anything this valuable before.
Screwdriver, I could adjust the angle of the mirror. Perfect. Now the viewfinder should be working. Screws still need to be put back. I felt a pang of envy as I handed the camera to Helena. I put my disposable to shame.
I picked it up on my first trip to Paris. It's a 1958 limited edition, the first of its kind. It cost me 3 months' salary. It was worth it.
I had no idea what 3 months' salary meant to Helena, but I was pretty sure it was more than I could afford. It was strange, really, that we were even staying in the same hotel. I'd picked this place because it was cheap and cheerful, but surely she could afford somewhere better? She took some test shots, fiddling with the camera settings until she was absolutely satisfied.
This work is immaculate. At least there's one person in this town who knows what they're doing. So sending you to me might be the first thing Carmen's actually gotten right.
I wondered why Helena had bothered coming if she thought so little of her sister.
I hear nothing from her for weeks, and then when she finally does call me, all she wants is money. If she thinks I'm lending her another penny, she'll have to convince me it's not a total waste of time.
That didn't sound good. If Hurricane Helena was about to hit, I hoped Carmen was ready.